I want to welcome all of you again to this moment of truth. Coming to you from the online service of True Believers Baptist Church. It is my prayer that the Lord Himself will continue to help you as you keep learning and understanding His words. In Jesus' name. Today we'll continue on our series, Jesus' teaching on the cost of discipleship. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, thank you again for bringing us all together here tonight to learn at your feet. Heavenly Father, we pray that you open the hearts, the eyes of our hearts. We want to see you through your word. Please speak expressly unto us. Grant us the understanding of your words. And let your name only be praised and be glorified. Thank you, Father. We appreciate you. Glory be to your holy name, O Father. Jesus' mighty name we pray.
Amen.
No pray.
Last week, I know I read up to verse 39. But actually, the conclusion of last week is supposed to be Matthew chapter 10, verse 37. Matthew chapter 10, verse 37. So last week, we concluded in verse 37, he that loveth father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and he that loveth son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And I explained that to us last week. So, please go to the website and see what we concluded. Let's move further. And Jesus Christ said further in verse 38, we're going to read Matthew chapter 10, verses 38 to 42 right now. And he said, he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. He that findeth his life shall lose it. And he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. He that receiveth you, receiveth me. And he that receiveth me, receiveth him that sent me. He that receiveth a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a prophet's reward. And he that receiveth a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward. And whosoever shall give to drink unto one of these little ones a cup of cold water, only in the name of a disciple, verily I say unto you, he shall in no wise lose his reward. The Lord bless his words in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
Now the Lord Jesus is making it clear here. Another cost of discipleship, or what it will cost you as a follower of Jesus, is that you need to take up your cross and follow Jesus. Now, taking up your cross can be seen in various ways. You need to be willing to suffer for the sake of Jesus Christ. That is one. All that Jesus have been saying right from verse 1 up to this moment is summarizing it in this particular verse right now. If you have refused to take up your cross, if you have refused to pass through all I have told you from verse 1 up to verse 37, because when you do all he says in verses 1 to 37, that is a sign that you are carrying your cross and you are following Jesus. Because when you carry your cross, it means you are willing to suffer for the sake of Jesus. It means you are not going to forsake him. You are not going to run away. You are not going to deny him. You are not going to say because you are passing through persecution in your house, your dad, your mom, who are not Christians, are persecuting you, or refuse to pay your school fees, or refuse to have anything to do with you. Because of that, you will forsake Jesus. Because if you do that, it means you have refused to carry your cross. And he is saying that, and he that taketh not his cross and followeth after me is not worthy of me. That means you are not worthy. You don't like Jesus if you don't do, if you are not willing to pass through all these things. As I told you, not all of us, all of us may not pass through these things in the same way. There are various ways we are going to pass through them. So don't be afraid that because it's going to happen, it happened to the disciples this way, it's going to happen to you that particular way. God has a way of helping us through every persecution so that we will not deny him. Everything possible to help you not to deny, to deny Jesus, God is going to grant it unto you. Because on this race we are running, you are not running the race alone. God is with you as you are going through in the journey. And I pray that we will not forsake the Lord in Jesus' name. So taking up your cross can also be seen as disciplining yourself to pray. Disciplining yourself to read the Bible. Disciplining yourself to worship with other believers as we are doing right now in the church. It is carrying your cross when you find time to pray, when you find time to read the Word of God, and when you find time to fellowship with believers, when you put the things of God first as priority, when God is first in your life, we've discussed it before, put God first. When God is first in your life, whatever you are doing, anything that comes your way that say you should not pray, you will not allow it to succeed. You will pray. Anything that comes your way that want to prevent you from studying the Word of God, you will not allow it. Even though it is sleep or hunger, you are hungry, you will not allow it to rob you of reading the Word of God and studying the Word of God. Anything that want to stop you from coming to church, maybe they are telling you to come to church on Sunday, and you say, no way, I can't come to church on, they are telling you to come to work, for example. You don't work on Sunday, and they say you should come to work on Sunday. You say, no way, I did not sign Sunday contract. I am not coming. I'm going to church. Anything that wants to stop you from putting God first, you reject them. When you do that, you are carrying your cross and you are following Jesus. Don't forget what Jesus Christ says. He says, be gentle. Be wise as the serpent, but what? Be gentle as a dove. So you need to apply wisdom in whatever you are doing. Allow the Lord to help you. Allow the Lord to guide you. I cannot come to explain some other things for you. There are some people that they need to be there on Sunday. There's no doubt about it. There are some people like that. But you that is not among those people, you're not in the medical line, you're not among them. And I've told you before that not everyone, because I have friends who are medical doctors, they still go to church. They go to church, oh. You that is giving an excuse not to go to church, the American doctors, they still attend church on Sundays. They still attend weekly activities in their various churches. I have friends and I have family members who are also medical doctors. So I want to challenge us. Taking up your cross involves all these. Because if you do not do them, then you are not worthy of Jesus Christ. And he said in verse 9, he that findeth his life shall lose it. You know what? If you are trying to prevent yourself from being attacked by the devil, number one, when you are preaching the gospel, don't forget, it says, and he that loseth his life for my sake shall find it. You know, for the sake of Jesus, for the sake of the gospel, the sake of Jesus, for the sake of the gospel, if you try to protect yourself, I'm not doing it, though. God will understand. You are trying to save your life. I've told you over and over again, we should not be afraid of death, because Jesus has gained victory over death. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid of those. Jesus Christ said it in this message, the series we are discussing. Don't be afraid of those who will kill the body and after that they have nothing else to do. But be afraid of God, who has power to destroy both body and soul in hell. So you don't need to be afraid. So don't try to protect your life. As far as you are in line with the gospel of Jesus Christ, I'm not saying that, oh, because of what you're saying, then you should just go and get yourself into trouble. No. You are not the troublemaker, you are a peacemaker. Don't go and enter trouble. When you see trouble ahead of you, I'm not saying you should shook your head and go and enter trouble. But as you are preaching the word of God, as you are doing the things of God, you are in the church now. You are in the church now. And suddenly just came in to say, no more fellowship, no more church. Run away from that way to kill you. And you run. That means you are trying to save your life. Why will you run? Why will you come and challenge me in the church? That I should run. I'm not running out anywhere. You want to kill me? Kill me here. If God allows you, except God, listen to me. Except the Lord God Almighty, except the Lord God Almighty has allowed you to die, nobody can snatch your life. No one can snatch your life. Except God says it is your time. And we don't know when God is going to say our time is up. Then why are you afraid? Because listen to me, no man, no human being, and no demon can kill you if your time is not up. So what are you protecting your life for? What are you protecting your life? And don't forget, don't get me wrong. I'm talking about protecting your life when you are in line with the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm not saying we should not take security seriously. That's what I'm saying, no. I'm not saying you should not take security seriously. I'm not saying you should open your door very wide. When you are sleeping, open your door wide. Don't lock your door. When you park your car outside, leave the key by the mouth. They will carry it now. That's not what I'm saying. So you better get me clear. I'm not saying you should not take security seriously. That's not what I'm saying. I'm talking in line with the gospel. We are in the church now. That is, we are all listening to the gospel of Jesus. And in your own closets, you are spreading the gospel, telling people about Jesus Christ, and there, somebody say, you better stop this witness in night, or I will kill you. You say, oh, you want to kill me? Okay, kill me. I will not stop. Now, if God has not assigned that day, the 31st of May, 2015, that you will die, you cannot die. That person cannot kill you. If they will shoot you, you will not die. If they stab you, you will not die. Why? Because it is not your time to die. So why are you protecting it? He that findeth his life, try to protect it. I don't want to die. Okay, I won't. Jesus, I'm going now. I'm going. I'm standing on the street. Tell people about Jesus. I say I should leave the street. Do you own the street? Except I'm in your house. If I'm in your house, I come to visit you, and I'm telling you Jesus in your house, and you say, get out. Jesus Christ said, you should do what? Get out. Dust your feet. Dust it. As a testimony against them. Say, okay, I am going. No, you don't hear about Jesus Christ. I dust my feet. I'm going. I dust my feet. It will appear as if I didn't come here again. That person is already in trouble before God. Amen. Amen. So, but if you are ready to die for the sake of Christ, if you are ready to lose your life for the sake of Christ, Jesus Christ said what? You will find it. Those of us who are ready to die, listen to me. Those of us who are ready to die, on the long run, we are going to live long. Because when the enemy discovers that you are ready to die, the enemy is afraid of you. If you don't know, you better know it now. When the enemy knows that you are ready to die, when the devil knows that you are ready to die, he will be afraid of you. Because the devil does not want you to make it to heaven. So why will he allow you to die? He needs you to be alive to frustrate you to deny Jesus. And after he has frustrated you to deny Jesus Christ, when you have not denied Jesus Christ, he will not come and kill you. But he has no power to kill you as long as you are a child of God and you have not denied Jesus Christ. So he will be afraid of you and say, this one is ready to die. And you know he would have come to try you. He will come and try to see whether you are ready to die. And he has tried you once. You are willing to die. You are not afraid. He will try the second time. Yeah, we are going to kill you. You are going to kill your son. So tell you, and you are not afraid. We are going to kill you. We will kill you. We will kill all your children. You are not afraid. He will say, no, let's not kill this man. Because if we kill this man, expressway to heaven. I don't want you to get there. I don't want him or her to get to heaven. If we kill him now, he's going straight to heaven. So let's leave him. Let's leave him. Let's go and plan another strategy. Let's go and plan. The Bible says, they will surely gather together. The Lord said, not by me. Anyone that rises up against you will do what? Will fall for your sake in the name of Jesus. That is the word of God. Don't be afraid. When the enemy knows you are not afraid to die, the enemy will be afraid of you. You think they want to kill you so that you go to heaven? No way. You know how to kill you to go to heaven, kill you to go to heaven, kill you to go to hell. So that you go and meet him and confront him and say, hey, well done, Mr. Preacher. Well done, Mrs. True Believers Baptist Church. Oh, Miss True Believer Baptist Church, you are welcome. All the church you carried in the air, you still landed in my own kingdom. You are in trouble today. You are in trouble today. I will deal with you, you will know. You are praying against me, Abby. You are welcome. Yeah, you have come to meet me here. You will be in trouble. But devil, you are the one that killed me. I'll kill you. And devil, you are the one that killed me now. You see, I was following Jesus Christ before. You are the one that killed me. You confused me. I confused you. Did I force you? Did you see me around? Did you see me physically that I was the one that made you to deny Jesus Christ? You are in trouble. I pray that will not be our portion in Jesus' name.
Amen.
That will not be our portion in Jesus' name.
Amen.
He that receiveth you, receiveth me. As we carry out the work of God, if people receive us, they have received Jesus. That means if they accept you to tell them about Jesus, if they accept the messages we are sending out to them, that means it's a sign that they have accepted Jesus Christ. That is a step forward. He that receiveth a prophet in the name of a prophet shall receive a reward of a prophet. And he that receiveth a righteous man in the name of a righteous man shall receive a righteous man's reward. Anyone that accepts your message, God is going to bless that person. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Anyone hearing me now around the world, and you are accepting this message that you are hearing, that you need to follow Jesus, that you need to surrender your life to Jesus, and as a disciple of Jesus Christ, those of you who are Christian, you are not afraid to spread the gospel. You are ready to go any length for the sake of Christ. And if you accept this word you are hearing today, you will be blessed by God. Hallelujah. And whosoever shall give to drink unto one of these little ones a cup of cold water only in the name of a disciple, verily I say unto you, he shall in no wise lose his reward. If somebody, because you are preaching the gospel, somebody is assisting you financially. Somebody say, Mr. Preacher, my friend, you have been doing so well. The person encourages you, gives you money, gives you drink, gives you food. The Bible says God is going to bless that person. God is going to bless that person. So listen to me. Don't blame people sometimes. When they see the pastor do sometimes some of these things they were doing, some of them are distractions. But don't blame people sometimes when the pastor has affected their lives. The pastor has affected their life through the word of God. Because the pastor is a man that hears from God and he has affected his life, and they decide to go and to go and appreciate the pastor. Don't be surprised. Don't be surprised. Those one of them, I would say, some of them distractions. Sometimes when the pastor is preaching, they run to the altar and throw money at the altar. Throw money at the altar. That is not too good. That is not too good. You don't need to throw the money at the altar. Everybody will see you. Just like I said, if you give your hand publicly, you have received your reward. So don't go there. Be throwing money at your pastor on the pulpit, on the altar. Don't go there. Put the money in envelope and go and give it to him after the service. And you are going to be blessed. It says he that gives any of this a cup of cold water in the name of a disciple, he shall in no wise lose his reward. So learn to appreciate evangelists, learn to appreciate pastors, learn to appreciate those who are spreading this gospel. Learn to appreciate them in your own way. Pray for them. It's not only monetary, something we're talking about. Pray for them. Whatever God lays in your heart to do for them, do it for them, because you will not lose your reward. And I pray the Lord is going to bless us richly and mightily in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
So this is the end of this of the message on the cost of discipleship. Now you have just heard the word of God. Are you a disciple of Jesus? Have you really, are you sure you're a disciple of Jesus Christ? You will be going to church. Now listen to me, going to church is not the issue. Do I encourage people to go to church? Yes. Part of carrying your cross is to go to church. But when you go to church and you yourself, you are not born again, then you are wasting your time. You're wasting your time. If you are going to church because you want to be born again, if you are going to church because you want to hear God speak, then you are doing the right thing. But if you are just going to church just to sit down there and say, right on, pastor. Oh, it's a very good message. I love this pastor. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And yet you are not saved. You will go to hellfire. Repent now. And those of you who have not even stepped feet, your feet on church, you have not even gone to church at all. Because you don't believe in church. You don't believe in church. Say, all these pastors are just eating our money. They are spending the money. See the pastor, they are getting richer and richer and richer. I've told you before, if you have been following this message online, leave them, let them spend the money. What concerns you? When you agree the money, what did you say the money is? God's money. Let them continue to spend God's money anyhow. It does not concern you. They have God to face. God is the one to give them judgment. Your own is that when you are giving the money, or when you are giving that gift, not only money, don't forget, not only money, as you are giving that gift to the church, you are giving it to God. When he lifts your hand, it's no longer your money, it's God's money. Let the pastor use it anyhow he likes. He or she has God to respond to. Let them squander the church money. They have God to answer to. When the money belongs in your is in your hand, it's still your money. No, it's not your money, it's God's money too, because he gave you the power to make that money. But when you go to the church and you release it, bam! Don't say, look at what they are using my money for. It's not your money. It has now become God's money. Leave them alone.
They are
going to face God's judgment. The ones that are doing that, they won't make it to God's kingdom. I am not praying that for them. But I'm telling them, you cannot steal from God and expect to be in his kingdom. Because if God allows you into his kingdom, all of us that will be there, you will steal all of our properties. So God will not allow you there. You will steal all our properties. You will be going from mansion to... You just can say, in my father I have many mansions. If God allows all people, they will be coming from mansion to mansion, they will be stealing in heaven. That's why God will not allow you to enter there, because you are a thief. So you won't get there. You can go to hell to go and steal. So if you have not given your life to Jesus, you need to surrender to Jesus Christ today. Bow your heads as we pray to God. Surrender to Jesus. So leave them. Not because of that. You are not going to church. I'm not going to church. They are just paying church money. Look at the pastor getting richer. And that's the hell. You will die and go to hell. Repent. Repent. We have personal relationship with God. Your relationship with God matters. Leave the pastors alone. You surrender to Jesus today. Talk to God. Say, God, I have vowed not to step my leg on church. But today, I've heard your word through your servant. I know I'm not going to church because of any person. I'm going to church because I want to make heaven. And so, Lord, please forgive me for the decision I've taken many years ago. Today, I repent of my sin. I'm a terrible sinner. I'm not even better than those in the church in the first place. But Lord, I am affirming that I'm a sinner. I've sinned against you. Please forgive me my sins. Lord Jesus, today I accept you as my Lord and Savior. Please write my name in the book of life. And grant me the grace to find a Bible-believing church where your undiluted word is being preached in the name of Jesus Christ. Help me, O God, in Jesus' name. And if you are just a churchgoer, you should also pray that prayer. And the Lord will hear you and will save you on the last day. In Jesus' name. Let us pray together. Lord, thank you for your word.
Lord, thank you.
We appreciate you. We magnify you. We exalt your name. Thank you for your word. And thank you for all your children around the world who are surrendering to you right now. Those people may still be contemplating, what is this guy saying? Some pastor may come across and say, you're just saying nonsense. You see this guy saying nonsense. I mean, turn it off. He's saying nonsense. How will you say pastors are squandering church money? Lord, I am not saying all pastors are squandering church money. If I'm saying that, I'm included. There are some out there who are doing these things. Please touch them to change. There are some there who call themselves pastors. They are not born again. They are just gathering people for church. for earthly gains. It's a business to some people now. It's their own business. And so they are making money through it. It's their business. So it's not God's money. Lord, help them to repent, because if they not repent, they will make it to hellfire. And so, Lord, as many today who have heard your word, and I say, Lord Jesus, I'm very sorry. And he or she is a pastor, an evangelist, a woman leader that is doing things that are wrong. Please, Lord, help them to change. And forgive them, O God, and help them to live a righteous life, a holy life, to the glory of your name in Jesus' name. Thank you for your word. We really appreciate you, Father. Jesus' mighty name we are afraid. Amen. Amen.